Welcome to today's lecture on the topic environmental pollution. So in particularly we will discuss about water pollution in this particular lecture. So before we go to water pollution, let us have a little bit details on what are the water resources that we have. So we have 97% of the water in the oceans, 2% in the ice caps, and only 1% is the fresh water. And within this 1%, we have contaminated or polluted the water to such an extent that less than 0.1% is fit for human consumption. So coming to the sources of water, we have surface water, rain water and underground water. So surface water, we have streams, rivers, sea, still water, we have ponds, lakes, reservoirs, and we have rain and underground water to our best. So coming to water quality index, we have something called as index value. In this particular case, your water quality is important. So it is not that how much liters of water I have. So what is the quality of that water which is there? So that is something to do with water quality index. So using this water quality index value, we can decide what is the quality of that particular water and we can use it for suitable purposes. So whether I can use it for agriculture, whether I can use it for aquatic life, whether I can use it for drinking purpose. So this is basically the criteria for quality index. So the water quality index range, it varies. So as I told, if it is very less, like 0 to 25 or 25 to 50, that quality of water is not that great. It is not good. So it cannot be used for drinking purpose. But if it is present between 90 and 100, it is good quality water, which can be used for drinking purpose. So in this way, if a water quality index is given to that water sample, it will help us in understanding whether that water is fit for human consumption or not. So coming to water quality standards, okay, we have something called as drinking water standards, IS 10500-2012. So these are the Indian standards which are given for various water samples. And this water samples will have various parameters. And if turbidity is high, that water is not good for drinking purpose. So it should be less, as less as enough. Okay, so it is like less than 1 is always better. So turbidity should be less. pH, if it is acidic, or pH, if it is basic, the water is not fit for drinking. So it should be in the normal range. 6.5 to 8.5 is the normal range of pH. And the water should be not hard enough. Like if you have hard water, it can lead to problems like it may not give lather with soap. It may lead to corroding of your steel materials. It can lead to hair fall. So there are a lot of side effects of hard water. So this is basically because of carbonates and bicarbonates, which can lead to temporary or permanent hardness. And if iron is present in water, it can lead to discoloration of your clothes. If there is lead, it can lead to various other problems, like it can lead to cancerous conditions. It can lead to various other problems. Coming to nitrates, so this is one which is present in water. It should not exceed 45 mg per liter. So if it exceeds 45 mg per liter, it leads to a condition called as blue baby's disease. So it is one thing where your oxygen carrying capacity of hemoglobin is reduced, because of which the baby will turn blue in color. So coming to water treatment, so the water that comes to your houses, it undergoes these steps of treatment before it comes to your house. So this is a typical water treatment facility. So in this case, if from the surface water, the water will be sent to this kind of treatment plants, where the solid content present in the sample, the turbidity present in the sample, all that will be removed using various chemical steps. So you have something called as chemical agent addition at the beginning, and once these kind of coagulants or flocculants are added, they will undergo a step of slow mixing, so that these chemicals will attach to the fine particulates present in your water sample. It forms bigger flocks which settles due to gravity. And once they settle due to gravity, the top water will be sent to a filtration unit, so that if finer particles are present, that also will be removed. And finally, it will be sent to chlorination unit, where it will be disinfected. So the water is disinfected and then it will be sent through the distribution system to your houses. So this is how a typical water treatment plant looks like. So coming to water pollution now. We know water pollution is leading to a lot of issues, and all our water bodies, that is the streams, lakes, rivers, all are getting polluted because of various industrialization practices. So the two types of water pollution that we have is organic pollution and chemical pollution. So organic pollution is due to the organic matter present, like animal, vegetable waste, because of organisms present like bacteria, viruses and other things. So chemical pollution is caused by chemical components present in samples, like your pesticides, your herbicides, your drug molecules, pharmaceuticals, household products. All these are leading to chemical pollution, and even industries for that matter leads to a lot of chemical pollution, which can lead to water pollution. So the causes of water pollution. So as we know, man is one person who is mainly responsible for a lot of water pollution. Okay, he is the main culprit. Apart from that, there are natural disasters like landslides, floods, which can again lead to water pollution. And once we use water, for that matter, the water which is coming out from the houses will be called as sewage or wastewater. And this wastewater, if not treated properly, can also lead to water pollution, because it will have a lot of organisms, it will have a lot of organic matter for that matter. It can lead to waterborne diseases if not handled properly. So there are sewage treatment plants or wastewater treatment plants which can be used for this particular purpose. Okay, so even urbanization for that matter is having an indirect effect. Okay, urbanization is nothing but growing mass population within a small area, due to which a lot of deforestation will happen. And we all know naturally plants will use water and they will purify the water. So in this case, your urbanization and deforestation is indirectly leading to water pollution. And you have agriculture, and agriculture we use a lot of fertilizers. So if they are using chemical fertilizers, they will emit a lot of nitrogen and phosphorus, and this nitrogen and phosphorus can lead to eutrophication of lakes. So what is this eutrophication? So this is nothing but algal blooms. We know algae and other organisms are present in water sample, or the water bodies for that matter. So once this nitrogen and phosphorus enters this water bodies, what happens is these are extra nutrients for this algae. So they start eating this nitrogen and phosphorus, and as they eat, they bloom. They start growing and growing, and leads to a problem called as algal blooms, because of which the entire surface of the water body will be filled with this algae, and because of which the water, the oxygen cannot penetrate inside. Okay, and because of which the dissolved oxygen, the oxygen present in water will be called as dissolved oxygen, this level will start depleting, and it will deplete to such an extent that the fishes present in that water samples will start dying, because there is no oxygen for their survival. So this will lead to a massive fish kill. So indirectly, if there is a fish kill in a water body, indirectly it tells you that it is because of eutrophication, or the excess nitrogen and phosphorus present in the water. So coming to industries, industries are leading to a lot of effluents. This effluents which is coming out from the industries is polluting the water bodies. So these industrial effluents are persistent organic pollutants which can accumulate and magnify in human bodies. So if you drink that water contaminated with this pollutants, it can lead to various other problems like cancer or neurological problems, etc. Marine dumping is also one major issue which is happening. Like your garbage such as plastic, paper, aluminium, all this will be dumped in the oceans. And we know these are non-biodegradable materials, and they take hundreds of years to decompose, because of which marine dumping is also a major issue. And radioactive waste, this is from the nuclear power plants. So these waste is actually managed properly with sophisticated structures, but if there are natural calamities and if there are cracks happening within the system, then it can lead to a lot of water pollution. So indirectly, these also are leading to problems, and we have certain effects of water pollution. So one effect is on the environment, where we have eutrophication, which we already discussed. One more is global warming. So water pollution, if a lot of organic matter is dumped in the water body and it is not undergoing aerobic decomposition, anaerobic condition prevails, it emits a lot of methane gas from it. And this methane which is emitted is a potent greenhouse gas, GHG, it is called a greenhouse gas, which can lead to global warming. So the temperature of the globe will start increasing, so such that the temperature will go high and high, and human survival in that particular globe may not be possible. So till that extent it goes on warming. So that is one major issue. Apart from that, you have thermal pollution. So what is this thermal pollution? So imagine you have an industry which is using a lot of water, and it is emitting a water which is at higher temperature. So it is at 80 degree, 90 degree, and this high temperature water is directly discharged into the water bodies. We know water bodies will have a lot of aquatic life, the marine life there. So it will hamper them, and if it continues, it may lead to a condition that the organism might become endangered. So in this way, thermal pollution is also one major issue which needs to be handled. So these are the effects of water pollution on environment. What about health? So health also, it has a lot of negative impacts. So it leads to a lot of waterborne diseases like cholera or typhoid. And some of the symptoms of that are dysentery, diarrhea. Sometimes it may lead to skin infections also. If water, contaminated water is used, to some extent skin infections are increasing in this particular era because of this kind of water, the contaminated water which is used for various purposes. And if you don't have enough water for drinking, it can lead to dehydration, right? So that is also one major. So coming to waterborne diseases, just to give you a few statistics, approximately 12 million deaths are happening per year due to this waterborne diseases. So this is mainly because of no proper sanitary facilities or no proper clean water. So these are the two reasons because of which waterborne diseases are increasing. And coming to some of the waterborne diseases here, you can just have a look at it. Organism, diseases and symptoms. So I've put a table so that you can just have an idea. What are the various organisms which can lead to waterborne diseases? What diseases it will cause? And what are the major symptoms of that disease? So I'll keep this slide for 1 or 2 minutes so that you can just have a look at different organisms, its diseases and symptoms. Coming to prevention and solution, how can we prevent this problem? So one is by proper sanitation and one is by providing clean water. So by these two practices, we can try to control the waterborne diseases to a maximum extent. So trying to use water treatment plants, trying to use proper storage facilities, cleaning those storage facilities frequently so that you don't allow the growing of algae within that storage tanks, personal hygiene, all this will help in reducing the waterborne diseases. So coming to water pollution prevention, wastewater treatment plant is one option. Okay, so there you have various treatment steps or trials, starting with physical, chemical and biological processes. It is also called as primary treatment of water, secondary treatment of water and advanced treatment of water. So in primary treatment of water, all the physical methods are involved, like your screening, so that if there is any plastic, paper which is floating on the water, they will be filtered enough. They will be filtered through certain filter systems so that only the water will move to the next treatment unit. Under the next treatment unit, you may have a chemical treatment like flocculation or something of that sort, or you can have a biological process where you will introduce certain organisms which will try to eat the organic matter present in the wastewater. So they will use this organic matter as food and in turn they will convert that to carbon dioxide and water. So you are trying to reduce the organic content present in the wastewater by trying to use microorganisms. Under this there are various systems that can be used. One or two examples are your trickling filters and activated sludge process. So these are the two systems which are widely used for wastewater treatment plants. And once you undergo this kind of treatment, your BOD, that is the biological oxygen demand of that water, decreases to a drastic amount. And once this is reduced, your water is safe. It is safe for various purposes. It can undergo the advanced treatment where you can go for chlorination for disinfection, or even you can go for membrane technologies. Those are the recent advancements where you try to use a reverse osmosis or you try to use various membrane technologies to remove the fine particulates, viruses and other things present in the sample. And finally, if you try to use advanced treatment for that matter, you can try to use the water for the industry again. So imagine this is a treatment plant of an industry. They are using advanced treatment like membrane technologies. After they are treating their water, they can use it for their process plant again. So that is how they are doing reusing of the water sample, and it can be getting certain credits like zero discharge company and all that. So there are a lot of certifications, green credits they get because of this. Okay, and apart from that, if you're not using the advanced treatment, you're just doing physical, chemical and biological treatment and it has some organic matter in it for that matter, you can use this water for gardening purposes, because we know organisms are present, nitrogen, phosphorus is present, it will become a manure, it will become a nutrient for your plants to grow. So you can use it for gardening purposes. So this way you can try to utilize the water which is treated for various purposes. One more is green agriculture. So here you can try to use organic fertilizers, and you can use fertilizers to such an extent that you know the soil quality. So once you know the soil quality, you already know how much nutrients are present in the soil. So this kind of testing can be done to see if I want to grow a particular plant, how much extra nutrients I need to add. So by doing this calculation, you'll be adding only that amount of nutrients that are required for the plant to grow. So you're not adding excess nitrogen and phosphorus. Are you getting me? Because if there is excess, what happens? It can lead to problems. It can get washed off, reach the water body. It can lead to eutrophication. We have seen all that. So that can lead to problems, right? So that is how, by using green agricultural practices, we can reduce this eutrophication and others. So coming to a typical structure, okay, I'm just showing you an example of a wastewater treatment plant, and at the right side, an actual wastewater treatment plant, how it looks. So wastewater, it tells wastewater, but 99.9% of that is water, and only 0.1% of that is solids. So under this solids, we have different criteria, organic solids and inorganic solids. So all these inorganic solids can be removed by initial primary treatment steps. Because they are heavy in nature, they will settle due to gravity. And organic matter, for that matter, it will be removed using your biological treatment steps, your trickling filter, your activated sludge process, where organisms are used. They will try to feed on this organic matter because it is food for them. So as they utilize it, your water gets cleaned. So that is why this kind of biological systems are used. And once they use this biological system, you get something called a sludge. The solid material there is called a sludge. And this kind of sludge can be sent to your digesters, anaerobic digesters, convert them into methane, which can be used for cooking purposes. And the waste sludge, which will be converted into manure, can be used for agricultural purposes. And the clean water can be chlorinated and it can be used for various other purposes. So in this way, you are managing your wastewater, plus you are generating a water source for you, plus you are creating your fertilizers from the same sample. So in this way, it is a green concept, and this will be the future. We won't have any water, we will have only wastewater with us, and we can use this kind of treatment steps and utilize it efficiently. So coming to prevention, water pollution prevention. So storm water management is one important thing that you have to take care, because we know storm water, we can try to reduce the runoff of this rainwater by rainwater harvesting. So this is one good option where you can try to harvest your rainwater and try to use it, because we know this water is not that contaminated. So if you cannot have a surface water, good quality water, rainwater can be a good source from which you can use it. And then you have air pollution prevention is one important thing that you have to take care, because your industries, for that matter, they emit a lot of air pollutants. They emit sulfur oxides, they emit nitrogen oxides, and these oxides of nitrogen or sulfur, when react with water, water vapor present in the air, it produces nitric acid and sulfuric acid. Can you imagine? Nitric acid and sulfuric acid will lead to acidification of your oceans. So once they acidify your oceans, their marine life and corals are hampered. Their life is in, becoming a problem there. So that is how air pollution also has to be prevented. And this has an indirect impact on water pollution. So plastic waste, I've already discussed. Lot of plastic is dumped here and there. Dumping is done. So this plastic is not biodegradable, and that can lead to a lot of problems. So it will contaminate your water bodies. Even if it is present in the treatment plants, it can clog your systems, and your waste treatment plant may not be functional. And you keep getting wastewater, but your water is not getting treated because of these problems, plastic problems. So that is one major issue. So that is why at the initial stage only, this kind of plastics will be removed from the treatment plant systems. That is by using certain filters. Okay, so that is why they use bioplastics now. Just Google bioplastics and you can get a lot of information on that. So these are the bioplastics, which are similar to plastics, which are produced from biological sources, and they are biodegradable. So they have the properties of plastic, but they are degradable, not like plastics, which take hundreds and hundreds of years to degrade. Okay, so in that way, plastic waste reduction can be a good option, and water conservation should be the only mantra. You try to conserve your water sources and think that water is a scarce resource. No need of thinking it. We already know it is a scarce resource, and we know how to manage our waters by using various techniques like rainwater harvesting and others for that matter. So thank you for listening to today's lecture.